Hello, my name is Gunter Weser from GWJ Technology Germany. Today I would give you a first introduction in our system environment, system calculation for gearboxes and other multi-shaft systems. The system manager is an extension to our single calculation modules of our web-based calculation software eAssistant or to our desktop application TPK. That means the system environment works with both standard calculation software solutions together. It's only a thing of a configuration. Now I want to switch to the system environment, and for this I call the system manager. And here in the system manager we have here different settings and possible options. But today I don't want to go in detail to these points. I would like to give you a first introduction, a first tutorial, how you can generate or how you can model a two-stage gearbox, for example, from the beginning, starting on a white paper or white wall. The system manager is a real multi-shaft system. That means in the background we have multi-shaft finite elemental model, and the shafts are coupled with the gears as nonlinear coupling elements. So if you want to model a gearbox, for example, a multi-shaft gearbox, we use normally groups, and so one group can have more than one shaft, for example. So for example, if you model a planetary gear system, the annulus, the planet carrier, and the sun shaft is, for example, in one group. But today, for this very simple introduction tutorial for a two-stage gearbox, cylindrical gearbox, we want to use three groups. And for this, I go in this navigation tree here. I go to this item shafts, and with the right mouse button I say add a new group, and again add a group, and again add a group. And in every group I want to have one shaft. So in the first group I have already a shaft, in the second group I say now add a shaft, and in the third group I say also add a shaft. Now I have my principal structure. Later I can reduce this or I can add some other shafts. This is very flexible, a very flexible system. And I can change, of course, also the groups or the name of the groups. So I select the group, for example, and I go to the register called group, and I change the name of the group to G1, for example. And I do this in the same way for the second group with G2. And the third group with G3. Now I go to the first shaft and I insert here a name for this shaft, and this should be my input shaft. And for this input shaft I want to specify also the speed and later also the torque, and all over should be calculated by the system, of course. So I go to the speed, I make this input field free, and I input here a speed of 1000 RPM, for example. Now I need some geometry, but at the beginning, in the first start, it's enough to work with a very simple geometry, like a beam, for example. So I start here with a shaft segment with 200 millimeters and a diameter of 20 millimeters. The detailed shaft geometry I can model later. We will see this, of course. And now I go to my loading elements, and now I insert a loading element with this plus button here. Now I select the kind of a loading element, like a coupling, and this should be my input coupling. So I call this only input, and the position should be at 5 millimeters, and the width should be 10 millimeters. That means the position of this element is in the middle of the element at 5 millimeters, and the element width is 10 millimeters in this case. And now I can input the torque. The torque, I select now 100 newton meters, for example, but I can change also the unit with the right mouse button on the unit, and I can switch to another unit like newton millimeters or kilo newton meters or some other nice units here. Yeah. So I go back to the newton meters, and with this I could work with plus and minus for the torque, for the direction of the torque. This is the own input, or I can select here shaft is driven or shaft is driving. And so I select here in this case shaft is driven from outside, so I input here the torque inside. Now I insert another loading element with a plus button, and I select the kind of this loading element, and this is a cylindrical gear, and this is our gear one. And this I make the position at 80 millimeters and a phase width of 30. And now I have a lot of more parameters to specify this, but this is not needed at this stage because it comes automatically later from the gear pair. It's only needed if you model a system like only with a single shaft. Yeah. And here I specify also the number of teeth, like 25, and module 1 only to see this element on the shaft. Now I need also supports, and I start with general supports, and I insert here a support, and name is support 1 at position 20, for example. And it's supported in retro direction and in both axial directions. And I insert another support, and on position 190, for example. If I use my shift button on the keyboard and the left mouse button and click on an element here, I can move this directly. This is possible for all elements on a shaft, and so you can have a dynamic positioning. Okay, and now I'm finished with this first shaft here, and now I could go to the second shaft, or with the right mouse button I could duplicate this shaft and move in another group, or I can split or mirror this. So I have a lot of more possibilities with this shaft, but for the moment I take this, and now I model my second shaft. And for the second shaft I go to the general, and here I say this is my mean shaft. And the speed is not activated, and so it's calculated by the system. I go in the geometry again, I insert a shaft segment with the same length and 20 diameters, zoom all, I go to my loading elements, insert a loading element, and this is a cylindrical gear, this is gear 2, on position 80, phase width 30, and 42 number of teeth. And I insert another gear, this is gear 3, on position 120, for example, and the 33 teeth. Yeah. And now I insert supports, of course. So this is support 3 at the same position as a fixed bearing, and support 4 at 190, only for radial support. And so I'm finished also with a mean shaft, and now I go to my output shaft. I insert the name, output, go to geometry, insert the length or shaft segment with 200 millimeters length and diameter 20, zoom all. Now I go to my loading elements again, insert a loading element, and this is a cylindrical gear, this is gear 4, at position 120 and 30. And number of teeth is 65. Okay. And now I need again the supports, of course. I insert a support with a support 5, on the 20 mm precision and support 6. And support 6 now at 180 mm as a regular support. And now I have to say the system where's my output torque, and the output torque should be calculated by the system or this torque. And so I have to insert also a constraint element. So this output coupling calculated by the system is not a loading element. It's a constraint, and so it's a support. So I insert another support element, and this is a coupling for reaction torque. And the name is output. And position is at 195, and this is 10 millimeters, for example. Now I have finished also my third shaft, and if I go to the shafts here in the navigation tree, zoom all, I see all shafts are at point zero in my coordinate system. Yeah. The next step is I have to say the system which gear is in contact with other gear, or what is the mating gear, and for this I have to define my gear connections. So I go to the gear connections, I go to cylindrical gear pairs, and with this plus button here I insert a gear connection, I select this, and now I say the input shaft gear 1 should be worked with the mean shaft gear 2, and the calculation used is the single calculation module for cylindrical gears from our web-based calculation software eAssistant, or I could select also the TPK. It's only a question of the configuration of my system calculation. And so it's directly connected to the single calculation module of the eAssistant at the moment. Yeah. And with the plus button, I insert a second gear pair, and this is the mean shaft, gear 3, and this should be worked with the output shaft, gear 4. And also connected to the eAssistant, and I can say, okay, this is blue, for example, so I have a different color for the second stage. And now I have defined this also, and the next and last thing is we need the positioning of the shafts in the system or in the space. And for this, of course, we could make it static with coordinates in the groups, for example. So if you use here the group, you have here the coordinates in the space and rotations. And so you could make the positioning in a static way, but this is not really comfortable and not very intelligent. And so for a flexible positioning, we use positioning rules. And for this, we go to the positioning. And with the plus button, we insert a positioning rule. And now we select the first inserted positioning rule, and now we select the kind of positioning rule. Here we have different possibilities, and the easiest way here also for start or for the beginning is to make the positioning of a group according to a gear pair. And now I have an imagination that my first group, G1, is at point zero. And all of our groups are have a relative position to that group. So I select here group 2, and I select here the gear pair. This should be gear pair gear 1 and gear 2. And here I can select an axial direction offset. So if I use 0 for the offset in the x direction, that means the middle of a phase width of gear 1 is in contact with the middle of a phase gear phase width of gear 2. And if I want to move this outside of the middle of a phase width, I could move this here with this value. And the angle is the positioning of a mating gear. Is it in 0 degree or 90 degree? 0 degree would be a vertical gearbox, 90 degree would be a horizontal gearbox, for example, and I want to use this as a horizontal gearbox, or you can use a value between this, of course, yeah, the 30 or 45 degree or something like this. And now I insert a second positioning rule, and I select the second positioning rule, and again group according gear pair. Now I select group 3, and with a cylindrical gear pair, gear 3, gear 4, with the same angle for the positioning. If I go now to the shafts in the navigation tree again, I have here now my shaft system here at the beginning. Yeah. And this I will save now, and so I go to File, Save As, and now I say this is a two-stage cylindrical gearbox with step 1. Okay. And with this flash button here, I can say calculate the whole system now. And so it runs without a message, so all constraints are fine, and we have modeled all things correct at this stage. The next step is normally the dimensioning of our cylindrical gear pairs. And after the first calculation, the torque is transmitted from the input coupling to the first stage, to the pinion. So we have the torque, the correct torque also for the first stage. And now we can go to the gear connections. And here we open the tree. And here we find the first stage gear pair. And if I select this, the program opens now directly in this system manager window my single calculation module for cylindrical gear pairs from the eAssistant or from the TPK. And now I can do my settings in detail for this cylindrical gear pair, for example, the tool. So I select here a very simple tool, for example, and the allowances. So I can select also the grade of accuracy for this gearing according to different standards, of course. Now I would like to use the DIN 6. And I can select the load capacity, for example, the ISO standard, and the power and the speed coming, and the endurance or lifetime coming directly from the system, and also the lubrication. And here I can select also my material, for example, for this. And now I can use my dimensioning function, or I can load an existing gear pair directly in the system. This would be also possible to use the open button here, File Open. So now I go to the dimensioning function. I can use here the external gear pair, for example, and the transmission ratio should be nearly or approximately 4. So I use between 3.9 and 4.1. And the number of teeth for the pinion should be between 14 and 25, for example. I could insert also a working center distance if I have some emissions or requirements for this. But all other settings, I use the standard settings for the beginning. And I say dimensioning. And now the program gives me nearly 400 recommendation variants, and I can sort this here or order this according to different values, like the normal module, the center distance, or the route safety, or the flank safety, or the transverse contact ratio here, like this. And for example, I select the smallest module, the first variant here, for example. I select this. I take this over with a K, and now I go to the profile shift coefficients calculation button, close the sum of X, and select the balance specific sliding, for example, for the splitting of the profile shift coefficients, say OK, and now I modify the working center distance a little bit, like 96, for example. And I could change also the phase width a little bit because my safeties are large enough. I will use this, for example. Okay. And this should be enough for our rough dimensioning at the moment. And we go back to the shafts here. And now the system is automatically updated after I have left the single calculation module. And now I say calculate to transmit the right torque to the second stage because I have changed the transmission ratio of the first stage. And the program identifies a problem with the flanks. So for the first gear pair, we have a double flank contact due to the very small shaft diameters and so on. And the message will go away later. We will see if you have specified this gearbox a little bit more. Okay. What you see, effects like this are also considered here in the calculation. And now I call the second gear pair. And I select here the same tool, for example. And the same grade of accuracy and also the ISO standard. And the same material. And I go again to the dimensioning. Before I use the dimensioning, I can say in the geometry it should be a helical gearing or a spore gear. So I decided it should be a spore gear. So I select here helix angle 0 degree. I go to the dimensioning, and now the transmission ratio should be approximately 3. I use the same standard settings now, dimensioning. And I ordered here is for the module, for example, I use this. Okay. I change again the center distance a little bit, like 119. Yeah. And I can reduce the phase width a little bit. Yeah. Okay. This should be enough for the first rough design. For example, I go back to the shafts here, and now the system is again updated here. Now I see I have a small problem here, a collision between these gears, and so I will change the positioning of the gears on the mean shaft. So I go to the mean shaft, I select the third gear here also, and I can move this, for example, on this position. Yeah. Okay, now it looks fine. And now we do the calculation again. And we will save this as the other version. Okay. And the next we can make the shafts more, we can model the shafts more in detail. And for this, I can call here with the graphics G1 or group 1. And I can call here the equivalent stress, for example, and I see how large is the equivalent stress. Or I can go here to the system item, display settings, and I see here the equivalent stress for required diameter should be 100 megapascal as a target value, for example. And with this, I go in the input shaft. I click with the right mouse button in the graphic window, and I call diagram and required diameter. And now I see how large should be the diameter for the first shaft. And now I go in the geometry, select here the first segment, and I say 10 or 15 millimeters with 25 millimeter diameter, and again 35 and 30 and 10 and width and 40 and width, for example, 33. And again, 50 and another 25, for example. Yeah, this should be my first shaft, and I will do this now also for the mean shaft again in the same way. I call the trial diameter and I change my geometry. Like this, and yeah, and yeah, 50, 45, oh no, 55 and 5 and 60 and 45, like this, and 50 and 25. 45, like this, for example. Yeah. Okay. And the last shaft in the same way, I call the diagram equivalent required diameter. And say 15 and 40. And 45, 50, 60 and 50 and 55. Yeah, like this. Okay, and if I have specified this, I can do the calculation again, and now this looks fine. Okay, and we will save this, okay, and now we can change our supports to roller bearings. So that's very easy. I go to the input shaft, I go to the supports, I select the first support, and now I change this support to a roller bearing. So I change the kind of support to roller bearings. And now I can use this plus button behind the type of a bearing to call the database. And here we have different manufacturers inside, of course. Yeah. And now I select here spherical roller bearings, for example, and I select yeah, for example, this FHAG bearing. Okay, and with say the name bearing one, and with this blue arrow button I can move this to the shoulder, and I can do this in the same way for the second bearing on this bearing two. And I select again spherical roller bearings, like this. And I can say this is only laterally supported. Yeah. And now I can go to the mean shaft. In the same way, you select roller bearings, bearing 3. And we use this, for example. And bearing 4, okay, And so we see we need a larger shaft geometry. And now we have enough space for this. Yeah, we can do this a bit smaller. Yeah, okay. Okay, and yeah, it's this is only an example, just an example. It should not be the best of the beautiful this gearbox. It's only to show what is possible, of course. It must not be a practical thing. And for the output shaft, I go again to this. I go to the supports. I select support 5. I select the roller bearing. And I change this also to a spherical roller bearing. Select 1. And here, the last bearing, bearing 6. And also spherical bearing. Yeah. Okay. And now I have finished this, and now I can go to my shafts. And now I see the roller bearings are only with the outer ring and inner ring, and without the rollers or the balls. And we will see these after the calculation. And now we say calculate again. And now you see also the red marked rollers have the load. And you see also here the pressure elliptical here. And so you see also what direction of the force, because these rollers are red, for example. Yeah. And now we will save this again. Okay, and now we have here for the gear connections, the safeties directly in this overview versus the safety for the root, for gear 1 and gear 2, and for the flank gear 1 and gear 2, for the first stage and for the second stage, of course. And in the shafts we see here with this register card also the lifetime of the bearings. And we see here in the result overview the smallest lifetime of this gearbox. Bearing life is nearly 140 hours. Okay, this should be really enough, I think. And so we have the bearing lifetime in one view here, in one table, and the safeties for the gears. And you have a very fast overview if you have a critical thing in the gearbox or not. So that means also in the result overview you see also the smallest flank safety and the smallest root safety in the whole gearbox here. Yeah, and we can calculate also additional to the bearing life and to the safeties for the gears also the shaft strength. And for this I go to the input shaft again. And now I call the graphics group 1 and the equilibrium stress again, and I see where are the equilibrium stress. And here in this graphic window I call with the right mouse button also the diagram for the equilibrium stress directly here in the shaft geometry. And now I select here with the register card sections, and with this plus button here I insert a section. And this could be a documentation point only to have information regarding the stresses or something like this, or forces. Or we select here a notch effect like a shoulder. And we can move this directly to the first shoulder. And with the shoulder 1. And I can insert here a radius of 2 and a roughness of 16, for example, for the first. And I would insert another notch effect. This could be also a shoulder with a relief groove or an interference fit or keyway or something like this. But I use the shoulder, and this is shoulder 2. On the next here with radius 1.5, for example, and another with shoulder 3 with radius 1, for example. Yeah. Okay. And if I have finished this, I have to specify the material of the shaft, of course. Here in general, we have a material of the shaft. This is in general steel, but this is not specific enough, so I have to select a real steel, and in this case I use the 20mm CR5. And for this I have also the necessary data for the strength calculation according to the DIN 743 standard. And now I can say calculate. And now we will see also the safeties for the shaft in the overview of the shafts. We will see the safety for the shaft for endurance, it means for the infinite life, and also for the static case. And so I go to the shafts here, and here to register cut shafts, and I see here for the input shaft, the smallest safety for the endurance lifetime or infinity life, and also for the static case. And if I go to the register cut sections, I see this in detail. For first notch effect, it's a safety of 8.74, and the next is a safety of 4.57. And you see in this shaft overview, I see only the smallest safety here again, and not all details. And so I have a very good overview here, and I can do this with the other shafts. This is also possible. We can work also, and this is the last thing that I want to show today, we can work also with a load spectrum. But this means we can work, or we can calculate with the load spectrum, or we can use the load spectrum function for the administration of different single load cases. And for this gives you also a very fine overview. For this, I go to the system, I go to the settings here, and I activate the load spectrum. And now I have a new item in my navigation tree, and I go to this, and with the right mouse button of this blank side, I can say general comment, insert, and for the input shaft in general, the speed, and for the input shaft, the input coupling, the torque for this, and I will add two elements. And here I will say this is case 1 and this is case 2. And the time is time part in percent is 50% for the case 1 and 50% of the time for case 2. And the speed is 1100 for the first, like we have specified at the input coupling and the input shaft. And here for a second load case, we use 2575. So if you have insert here a load spectrum, this has priority regarding to that you have in, specified directly at the input shaft. Yeah. And if we select nothing more, so we can calculate this as a load spectrum. So this flag here is deactivated. And I go to the gear connections, and now I say calculate. And now we see the results for the load spectrum, and here the torques for the single load cases. Yeah. And now we go back to the load spectrum, and now we say run the calculation only for a specific result element, and this should be load case 2, so element 2. And I go back to the gear connections and I call the calculation again, and now we see the safety is only for load case 2. Okay. This was what I was looking for to show you for today. I hope I could give you a good overview or a good first introduction to do the first steps by your own to use this system environment. We have a lot of more possibilities to model different kind of very complex gearboxes or very simple gearboxes. We have all the possibilities, and you can calculate also eigen frequencies of a whole system, and you can optimize flank modifications to consider also the bearing stiffness, or you can work with 3D elastic parts. These are 3D Elemente meshed parts for the gear body, or to consider the gear body stiffness, or also for planetary carriers, also to consider the deformation of the planet carrier regarding to the flank modifications or the line load distribution along the face width. Or we can consider also the housing. So you can import a housing as a step file with the automatic mesh, for example, and you can consider this for the stiffness and also in the eigen frequency calculation. And a lot of more, so you can work also with power split gears or switch gears, gearboxes, and so on. Yeah, but this was a first small introduction in how you can work with this. We have also some examples that you can load as a template, and you can model, and you can start with the modeling with this, or you can start only on a blank side. Here, for example, like I have shown this, we will show you also some other possibilities of the system environment in further video tutorials. And if you have some questions, you can contact us, of course, via email or via our website, gwj.de, for example. You are really welcome, and your feedback is also really welcome. And for today, I thank you for your time. Thanks. Bye-bye.